I am delighted to be participating in this event from one of our remote centers in Nashik. This is the last session of all face-to-face interactions, and therefore I wish to use this opportunity to say a few things before I come to the discussion on the topic that will be discussed in this FDP over the next 2 weeks. A couple of things which I wanted to say were as follows. First and foremost, almost 2,500 teachers have been consistently participating in all activities, although the overall registered participants were 4,000 to begin with. A large number dropped out right at the beginning when they saw the assignments that were to be completed and submitted. Perhaps they lost heart. Some people realized that it's going to be a very long drawn affair. So they had perhaps thought that it would be like a 100-meter race. When they found out it's a marathon, they lost heart. But we had somewhere between 2,400 to 2,800 participants consistently working right from the beginning. I would like to use this opportunity to compliment all of you. As I had said at the beginning, this kind of FDP has never been conducted in the country earlier, and the All India Council of Technical Education is so excited that they want us to conduct this FDP for all 5 lakh teachers of professional colleges in the country. Now that's a very tall order. A taller order is they want us to finish this in next 3 years. And as an added attraction, they have said that please do it, Professor Fatak, but we don't have any funds to give you. These are the kind of challenges that not only the technical education faces, but the whole country faces. And we have to answer these challenges by coming together and working on our own. So this is the culminating set of weeks for the first ever historic FDP, which concentrates on this aspect. Some of the learnings that we had from this FDP is that instead of conducting a comprehensive 4-week equivalent FDP, which takes more than 12 weeks to complete because 10 weeks of online activity has to be completed before, we have decided that we'll break this FDP into 2 parts. The first part will concentrate on foundations of ICT, where we'll cover all the common technologies and their knowledge in a shorter framework of a FDP equivalent to 2 weeks, which will mostly be conducted online. The second component, which relates to the pedagogy of effective use of technology in education, will be covered in another FDP, which is equivalent of 2 weeks of work, which of course, if you consider the online activity, it will run for at least 5 to 6 weeks with some interaction. We may not have remote centers as the only places for that interaction. Right now on the drawing board, many of my colleagues are working out the modalities, but we are clear about one thing. If we have to conduct these programs in future to cater to a very large number of professional colleagues, then IIT Bombay or IIT Kharagpur alone cannot do this task. We will need assistance and help from committed professional teachers who are willing to give their time and effort for helping us. And that is the reason why we have conceptualized a scheme of teaching associates. And where from these teaching associates will come? Well, to begin with, they will come from amongst the 2,500 teachers who are participating in this FDP. I look forward to seeing more of the passionate people amongst you who are willing to lead this effort with us, so that the learning that we have is communicated to a much larger number of our colleagues all across the country. I would like to repeat that in this matter of the newly emerging pedagogy on effective handling of ICT for greater quality of education is not something on which textbooks are available or standard materials available. All of us are learners. People in IIT Bombay have been more fortunate for having experimented with these things over the last 5 years. So perhaps we know a bit more. Now you know something. As you go back to your colleges and practice some of these, at least a few of you could become better experts than even us at IIT Bombay. And together, we hope to take this style and technique to greater perfection so that the entire Indian education system of higher education, higher technical education benefit. So this is the first point I wanted to share with all of you. The second point is not very pleasant. As I had observed last time that we noticed a few cases of undesirable plagiarism where some of the colleagues were tempted to copy submissions of their friends and submit those submissions as their own. And in IIT, we take these things very seriously. They generally don't occur, but when they happen, the penalty is very harsh. I was quite surprised that why such things are being detected from amongst teachers, because we are not dealing with students, we are dealing with teachers. But then my colleagues told me that, Pathak, human being is a human being. After all, were you not tempted to copy an assignment when you were a student? I said, yes, I did. Then, when you grow, what is the reason why you will not give in to that temptation if the chances are bright that you will not be caught? So I grudgingly agreed that, yes, I might fall to that temptation. However, I still hold that as a teacher, we have a greater responsibility to demonstrate higher values, and we cannot demonstrate these unless we imbue these values ourselves to the perfection. Since it is entirely possible that we might be tempted, because temptations occur in life for a variety of reasons, that is the reason why I had thought of an alternative where I requested people to give a feedback, admitting clearly in case they were prey to such temptation, and they mention exactly what they have copied and from whom. I was again surprised that more than 200 people, more than 200 participants have actually confessed that they were prey to this. While I feel sad that there are so many teachers who fell prey to such temptation, I also feel proud that the same 200 people had the courage to come forward and say, yes, we did that, it was a mistake, we are sorry, we'll not repeat it. Believe me, my dear friends, it requires tremendous guts to admit a mistake. To commit a mistake is relatively easier, but to admit a mistake and to correct it. So I compliment all those 200 plus friends who have shown that courage, and I'm sure that they will never ever permit themselves to be tempted like this in future. I would suggest that all others who have not indulged in such practices should note that temptations in life can occur anytime. Not necessarily now, they may occur next year, they may occur year after that. Particularly when many of our faculty colleagues are pursuing their research, many are working post their PhD on research work with the research scholars. Several of our colleague teachers are actually themselves doing PhD, and many others would be soon following. And that is an area where the temptation to copy material from somebody else's work is the greatest. You might have heard that very recently, a vice chancellor of a university in Puducherry was caught doing this plagiarism. The act was caught last year. She submitted her resignation but did not submit it properly. She is now being removed forcibly. That is the downfall, my dear friends, that may occur if we fall through such temptation. It is therefore very, very important that we uphold these values. And once again, I will say that while I feel sad that so many of our participants were tempted, but I feel immensely proud that they had the courage to come forward and say, yes, we made a mistake, and that it will not happen again. In this context, I would again like to mention the importance of open educational resources on which you have had a large amount of discussion earlier. Coupled with open educational resources is the matter of open source software, which permits us to use that software freely, modify, distribute it, and therefore I can legally use something which otherwise might require obtaining a license at the cost. In the context of open source software, I will mention some discussion which happened yesterday. I was sitting with my colleague, or in front of my colleague, Mr. Kannan, when he was talking about use of spoken tutorials in teaching people different things. And then there was a question saying Scilab, which is one of the open source software, having the same functionality as the well-known commercial product MATLAB. Many teachers said that our students are more comfortable with MATLAB. They are not comfortable with Scilab. And his answer, I think, was that the matter of comfort comes out of the matter of exposure and the matter of practice. However, if your people and you are comfortable using MATLAB, absolutely no problem. Make sure that every copy of the MATLAB that is used by any student on any computer at home or in the lab and by the teacher is a licensed copy. Now that is a hard problem, because many of our institutions are not careful about checking whether the software is actually licensed software or not. Please understand that if we do not respect the intellectual property right of others, the rest of the world will never respect our intellectual property that we create. So in a nutshell, you are of course welcome to use any piece of software that you feel is required to do the necessary work. However, ensure that the software that you use is legal tender. If it is a commercial product, ensure that you have a license which is properly paid for. If you can't afford that license, then you must use an open source free software instead. I will tell you an instance where this happened, not now, but 30 years ago, when one of the researchers in a company, Godrej company, which was doing research in graphics then, was attending a conference in Germany, and in that, not conference, a trade show, and in one of the stalls he was shown a particular utility which was extremely good. He wanted to see something more, and he says, yes, I can show you that something more, but that requires an additional piece of software. I have it loaded on the machine, but I don't have license to run it. The license is only on the machine which is in my lab, which is 100 miles away. But if you are willing to spend time, I will drive you there, show you that, and then I will bring you back. He did that because he did not have the license to run that software on that machine. Do we inculcate these values amongst our students? Do we insist that no student shall ever use unlicensed software? Do we do it ourselves very carefully? We unfortunately don't. And that is a national problem. So I'm not blaming anyone in particular, but this problem will have to be solved. It is this habit of not respecting the law of the land, which says that if there is a proper commercial software, it must be paid for before I start using it, tempts us to do many other things also. Copying somebody else's material and passing it on at one's own research work is nothing but a avatar of the same philosophy, that I don't care if I use anybody else's work. I would once again emphasize, and no amount of emphasis is good enough, that all of us must be extremely careful in ensuring that intellectual property is respected and protected. One of the reasons why we have embarked on this large-scale effort on creating open educational resources is that all learners can freely utilize it, and they can do so perfectly legally. Now I come to the second part and the main part of my session, which relates to the next 2 weeks of our online activities, namely building and nurturing collaborative community. All of us are very comfortable working alone. When I work alone on a given task, I see several advantages. First of all, I can do that work at any time and place that I choose. I don't depend on others. Second, I control the quality of that work. So I don't have any meddling from others. Third, if there is a team of people, then I have to live with the idiosyncrasies of those people in the team. And this is not only related to their different professional competences, but their work habits, their behavior. You know how difficult it is for multiple people to work together. Even personal interaction could force a problem. So these are some of the disadvantages because of which I would like to work alone. However, let us look at the advantages of any team working together. First of all, when I work alone, the amount of time that I can spend is always limited. After all, there are only 24 hours in a day. If instead three or four people work together, each one can contribute substantial amount, and therefore the sum total of the efforts that a team can put in is always larger than the effort that any one person can do. In fact, that's an oxymoron. It's a mathematically proven fact that sum total of n number of people's effort is always greater than the effort by one person. But I might want to add greater than equal to. Why? Because if all other members are sleeping members, that means they are only notional members, but they don't do any work, then the contribution will be only same as my own contribution. So it is to be understood and assumed that the team actually contributes. In fact, it contributes in such a meaningful fashion. Then, as it is known, many times 2 plus 2 does not become 4, but it can become 8, 10. So if 4 people work instead of 2 people, and if they work in a coordinated fashion, in a collaborative way, then the total work is quantitatively and qualitatively much better than what a single individual can do. This is not just to say that teamwork is important, but I will also add one more thing. If you look at problems that engineers and scientists of this century are expected to solve, they are all multidisciplinary problems, as I have already mentioned once. These problems are both complex and multidisciplinary, and therefore cannot ever be solved by a single individual. They are all to be solved by multiple teams working together. And these teams must collaborate and coordinate their efforts. Sadly, we have not developed habits of working together efficiently. More sadly, we have no component in our curriculum which will train our students to work together in teams. In our IIT system, we invariably have group projects, which are part of every subject that we teach, or many subjects that we teach. In other engineering colleges, the group projects take the form of only the final year project that the undergraduate students do, and they usually have a team of 3 or 4 people working together. Unfortunately, they have no guidance till then on how to work together effectively and efficiently. They have no guidance till then of how plagiarism is bad and that they must do their own effort and document their own effort. As a result, you see a large number of BTEC projects and MCA projects which are ditto copies of some earlier project. This, my dear friends, is spreading like a cancer in this country, and that cancer has to be removed. There is no choice in front of us. And the flag holders of this campaign has to be teachers. It will not happen otherwise. I have suggested a few things, although it is a digression, but I will repeat that. Every college must make it obligatory that every project work done by either a single student or by the team, every research paper that is sent for publication by a faculty member or a team of faculty members must be displayed publicly on the website of the college. If that is not done, no degree should be awarded to students and no paper should be accepted for publication from teachers. This single simple act will immediately prohibit people from falling temptation to copy from somewhere and do it. Because public scrutiny, transparency, after all, that is what the government keeps saying, that e-governance means openness, transparency, and that means correct things will happen, wrong things will not happen. Sorry for this digression, But it is very, very important that through our efforts, we spread this message across the country and try to ensure this. Talking about the license behavior, I will again urge all participating teachers that when they finish this FDP or even otherwise, they should raise this matter with their own institute authorities. They should raise this matter with the labs in which they are in charge for the equipment, hardware and software. And if there is something which is illegal or something which is not properly respecting the IPR, they must object and they must immediately stop using such things. There is no shortcut to that. There is a harsh medicine that is required because, as I said, it is spreading like cancer, and cancer requires surgery. It cannot be controlled by ordinary medicine. And we are therefore all qualified surgeons now who will have to undertake that surgery. Let us come back to, therefore, the main topic where we want to establish and nurture collaborative community. We start with a small team effort. That is the reason why there is a team assignment to be completed by all participants after the online portion gets over. All of you have formed teams. I have gone through many of the teams. Many teams are properly done. They are between 2 to 4 people as was required. They have identified the main domain in which they have an expertise. Now they will have to define a subdomain for the particular work which they wish to do together. The nature of the work will be in the form of an OER generally. That OER could take various shapes and formats. For example, some team might just decide to create a video lecture or a set of video lectures explaining some concept. Some team might decide to design quizzes with questions, answers and explanation. Some other team might decide to give the description of a possible course project that can be done in one of the subdomains of their domain. As long as any work that is undertaken is done with an intention to provide an extremely good quality, useful resource, and usefulness will be decided by the people who will use it. Please remember, all the work that you submit as your team assignments will definitely be released as a part of the OER repository of these FDP. And therefore, that will be available and accessible to lakhs of teachers and millions of students. And that is the reason why we must actually try and do this team assignment work very, very carefully and seriously. I also noticed that in few remote centers, I have come across teams which consist of only one person. I can see why that might have happened. I mean, I put myself into the shoes of that person and I realized what I just mentioned some time ago. I am more comfortable working alone. If I have 3 more partners and if all 3 turn out to be sleeping partners, then I will end up doing all the ghodagiri. If those people are not sleeping partners, but they do not contribute meaningfully, they do shoddy work, their documentation contains errors, then I'll spend my time in correcting those errors. These are the reasons why I'm tempted to work alone. But the point is, we want to actually nurture the notion of working together in team. When I work in team, even if I consider myself to be the best person in that team, I must realize that because I'm the best, perhaps I have a greater responsibility to take others together with me. And please remember that in a teamwork, even if I'm the best, I will always learn something from every other team member. Because every human being, every participant in any team has some very plus points which are so unique that they are not available in others. We can learn from every other human who works with us something or the other. It is not necessarily the technical competence alone, but it is behavioral niceties, the way of functioning, meticulousness, so many characteristics which individually we may not possess all of them, but a team will contribute to that. When the teams work in a manner where they are not physically at the same place, it puts some additional problems in the path of the teamwork. For example, consider there is a team of four people. All four of them actually work in different cities. Now, how will they work together? That is the reason why in the afternoon session today, and this you may want to note down, the major part of the second session, I understand that Dr. Samir Sahasrabuddha's assignment of a peer assessment has to be completed. The time has been extended till today evening. So you might want to use the part of the first afternoon session to complete that. If you have already completed, you can directly go towards the contouring of the teamwork, which I will now explain. So let us come back to the case where four people have to do a teamwork over a period of time, but they are all not coming to a common place as colleagues in the college or as students in the same class. Even if they are, they have to work individually from the precincts of their home or from the precincts of their office when the other members of the team may not be there. This asynchronous nature of teamwork is increasingly going to be the common factor in almost all team efforts. Even today, you will find large teams which do software development for companies like Tata Consultancy Services jointly with their partners such as Boeing or Microsoft or whatever. You will find teams of about 200 people spread across 25 places and yet working like a military operation, perfectly planned and coordinated. And that is exactly what we need to first learn ourselves and then teach our students how to do that. Unfortunately, the domain of management, which deals with project management and which therefore has a complete set of systems on how to handle teams and teamwork whenever the teams do a project, that knowledge is not accessible to scientists and engineers, because that is considered, project management is considered a topic under management domain, which is not in the syllabus of any engineering or science discipline. It is very sad, but what I am trying to suggest is that if we have to perfect the teamwork that we will do, it is mandatory that we learn from our brothers and sisters who practice management. And at least the project management component, we should try to learn their best practices. Unfortunately, this FDP cannot cover project management in its entirety. But I would like to mention today a few things which all of us must learn, few very basic things, and then practice those while we do the teamwork for the team assignment and later when we train our students to work in teams. So let me take matters in sequence. There are five things which I am going to mention and you may want to note down. Number one, handling team communication. How do you handle team communication? The team communication can be handled either through face-to-face meetings or through emails. There is no other mechanism. If emails have to become the standard way of handling communication, there are several things that need to be pre-decided and pre-agreed by the team. Simple thing, what should be the subject line of an email which is related to this project? What are the email IDs of the team members? Many times we do not have this information easily available. Today afternoon, therefore, the first task that you'll have to do is you will have to ensure that each member of the team has a copy of the complete contact details of all team members. Preferably in a soft copy, but also preferably as one single page or hard copy where email IDs and telephone numbers are written down for all the team members of the team. Additionally, since all teams at a particular remote center form a larger group, although the individual teams in that group might be working on different problems, but collectively they do form a coherent group in the sense that they have an affiliation to that remote center. Therefore, this information must be available with the workshop coordinator of the remote center. If you have not already done that, please ensure that this is done as the first task today in the afternoon session. Whenever you exchange messages through email, as I already mentioned, you must standardize on what should be the line in the subject that you will mention. Because invariably when we read our email, the first thing that we read is the subject. And if the subject is blank, or if the subject is arbitrarily written, then we are not able to correlate what will be the content. The email itself should be short and brief, but succinct and carefully written. People think that they can afford to write bad English in an email only in a document which is to be formally submitted, which is a properly word processed. They should take care of correcting all grammar and spelling mistakes. That is not correct. Even an email communication has to be as perfect as a document that you will prepare. Mistakes can happen. Even I make mistakes. But I will tell you a habit which I have developed. Even if I write a slightly longish email having two paragraphs, I never press the send button unless I have read it at least once completely and carefully and tried to see whether there is any spelling mistake or grammar mistake. Then only I press that send button. This is a discipline that we must inculcate. And this discipline must be visible amongst all the team members who collectively interact through emails. The second important thing about the communication is that you often have to exchange documents, images, video clips, or whatever material that you are preparing as a component for your team assignment. What should be the format of such files? And what should be the names of such files? Naming conventions in files are extremely important, because otherwise there could be a large number of files with very same or similar names, causing confusion as to what does that file contain. You have to evolve a file naming convention amongst the team members so that whenever you attach files, everybody will know from the name of the file itself roughly what that file should mean. The format in which the data in that file should be stored should also be pre-decided. For example, if it is to be an editable text file, such that I prepare that file and a colleague of mine in the team might have to modify that file later, then the file has to be editable. If it is a text file, you may decide whether it should be a .txt file, it should be a .odt file, like open document format for open source word process, or it should be a .doc file for Microsoft word processor to be used. My request is, make sure that if you decide that all editable text files will be .doc or .docx files, then make sure that all the members of the team have access to legal copies of Microsoft Office. If you do not have access to legal copies of Microsoft Office, you cannot use that software to edit those files, period. It is blasphemy. It is a criminal offense, and we will not commit crime anymore. In the worst case, use ordinary text files. That is perfectly fine. Better still, use open source word process. Of course, if you are more comfortable with Microsoft or any other proprietary package, go ahead and buy the license and then use that license. But since now we are talking about a team effort, suppose there are four members. Three of us have, let us say, software license for the best package for photo editing, because we might be working on creating some engineering drawings or photographs. But the fourth person does not have the license. Now the fourth person says, boss, if you do this, I will not be able to contribute anything. I can use only this open source software. For the benefit of that one person, all the remaining three must agree to use that software which is commonly used. I am elaborating, but it is very, very important that initially itself, the team decides what kind of pieces of software will be used to prepare that project, and what kind of communication standards will be established. The second thing is about the decision of the activity itself. The activity itself, as I said, could be a project of your choice that you may decide to do, generally resulting in an OER. And as I already mentioned, think about the possibilities that three or four of you or two of you, whatever be the team size, can do together. But let us be very clear about this, that team effort is expected to be equivalent of, what should I say, 2 days of full-time work. That is what is the team effort. 1 day of full-time work is 8 hours, on and off. 2 days of full-time work is 16 hours. That means each individual member must put in, honest to God, 16 hours of work. Since the coordination in team takes away some time, this will be plus or minus something. Plus but not minus. Now this effort obviously cannot be put in a single day, because all of us have to do so many other things. I would submit that the best way of going about it is to divide the work such that you can spend 2 hours every day. The advantage will be that you will have to attend to emails which come from your colleagues. There will be some consolidation and coordination of the work that will have to be done. And therefore, spread the work in a time frame which is suitable for all of you. The time limit that has been announced for submitting the team assignment is 2 weeks after the conclusion of the 10 weeks. That is, whenever the 10-week online activity of the FDP ends, you have to complete and submit the team assignment. 4 weeks is the time. Because 4 days of work, not 2 days of work, but 4 days of work has to be done for the teamwork. So the total amount of effort is about 32 hours of effort on each individual. And that's a huge amount of effort. Now you may not take 4 weeks, you may compress it to 2 weeks, you may compress it to 3 weeks, you may even compress it to 1 week if all the team members are sitting together and working at the same time. But suffice it to say that the material that you produce and the records that you submit along with it, I will explain what records you will have to submit, must demonstrate very clearly that every member of the team has put in the required amount of effort. Please note that the OER that you produce not only should be usable, not only should be high quality, but it should be almost like a work of art that you should be proud of. Because hundreds and thousands of people are going to look at that. Your names are going to be written on that OER. Your names are going to be remembered. And therefore, it should be a matter of great pride that you perform that act of art very, very carefully and diligently. Coming back to the scheduling of the activity that I mentioned, such a team has to be coordinated and there has to be one team leader. Multiple people cannot take decisions on the same topic, and therefore every team has to have a leader. Normally, as we shall see over the next 2 weeks, in larger teams of volunteers which emerge to support typically open source software development or any other activity, leadership emerges. Here we do not have time for leadership to emerge. I understand that the team formation which has been provided by all the participants already has the name of a person as the team leader. Am I right in assuming that? That the teams already have a team leader. I would like to advise the team leader as follows. You are not leader because you are extraordinarily better than all others. You are one of amongst the equals. They are all your peers. Leading a peer group is far more difficult than leading a hierarchical group of juniors. Since they are all equal, the leader has to demonstrate the ability to take everybody together. One has to blow hot and blow cold. Somebody will miss out on a deadline and everybody else will suffer. Now the leader has a choice of shouting through a harsh email or has a choice of picking up the phone and speaking sweetly, "Will you please do this quickly because everybody is waiting for it." There are multiple ways of handling this, and this should teach us a whole lot about human interaction. But at the end of the day, once a person is named as team leader, for good or bad, whatever the team does, the team leader gets maximum credit of the team's work, and team leader also gets the maximum debit of the team. If the team does not perform, the whole team will lose out on the credibility, but the leader will lose out most. What should the leader do? And this is the next task that the leader should do jointly with the team members today itself. Namely, decide on the exact schedule. So define that when the 10 weeks of face-to-face interaction finishes, or even earlier if they so wish, what are the kind of activities that individuals of the group will undertake? What will be that frequency with which emails will have to be sent by team members? What will be the frequency of consolidation of the material? Who will do what review when? When final documentation of that OER will be commencing? Who will do that review and correction? And when that final documentation along with the OER is fully ready to submit? These are not trivial activities, my dear friends. One suggestion is keep the frequency of at least 2 emails per week, if not 3 emails, which are mandatory to be sent by every participant, independent of whether any substantial work has been done during that period or only very little amount of work has been. We will suggest a comprehensive mechanism whereby we will be able to track all the emails, because the email exchanges, you will have to send a copy to a specific address which will outline, so that all the emails that you exchange within the teams are available and accessible for the backend team to look at, because that will display the effort and the frequency at which such effort is. But what is more important is the coordination of these efforts has to be done at the level of the team. Please spend time today afternoon in discussing the modalities of how you will complete this particular task. In the remaining 2 weeks, in the first week, I will be discussing some of these modalities. So discuss these modalities and try to finalize to your at your end what you would like to do and how you would like to do it as part of the teamwork for the assignment that you have chosen. However, don't freeze it. Please wait for the discussion that will happen over the next week. In the online portion of the next week, you will have inputs precisely helping you to decide on these matters, or how people take decisions. If you think some of the inputs, some of the suggestions make sense, you may try to incorporate those and modify the decisions that you have taken about the communication, about the file formats, about the methodology, about the scheduling, etc. The fourth important thing that you will have to do is to maintain a tracking record. Basically, it is like the history of your activities. We are very bad at writing our history, as I already mentioned earlier, but it is important that we learn to write the history of the activities that we do. Ordinarily, such history is written by professionals by accumulating daily timesheets. I think I had mentioned it once that when our students go and take up a job, they don't have to just sign the attendance, but every day they have to fill up a timesheet saying what they have done in the day and how much time they have spent on each activity. So I might say I have spent 2 hours in reading something, 1 hour in drafting something, 1 hour in writing an old report, 2 hours in reviewing some design. Whatever work I do, I am required to write it. It does not take more than 2 to 3 minutes. But unless I put in the timesheet at the end of the day, I don't get paid for that day. That is the standard way in which industry works. We don't work in that way, and our students don't work in that way. But when it comes to doing a project, it is important that we learn to maintain the project diaries and the account of the time that we spend and the nature of activity for which we spend that time. I might spend some time in writing emails or reading emails from my partners, but much of the time I am going to spend on doing a part of the activity which has been assigned to me jointly by the team. And that part I will be doing at my own chosen time. Generally, I may not keep any record. Believe me, if we don't keep any records, 6 months later, if I were to ask you, how much time did you spend on the project? you will generally say about 30 hours, 25 hours, 40 hours or something. All right. How much of that time did you spend in writing something? I don't remember. How much of that time you spent in thinking about an idea? I don't remember. Because our memory is short. We don't remember these things. The only way we can remember is if we, whenever we carry out an activity, we actually write it down. Now, we don't have the habit of writing diary. Even if we were to write our diaries, they would generally contain the personal observations of what happened in a day on every day. We are not talking of that. We are talking about a professional diary. In the next week, I will be giving you a format, a suggested format on which such diaries are maintained. We have been using these formats for the project work that our students do in some of our courses. For example, when our students do a team project in CS 101, which is an introductory programming course, then apart from the project code that they have written, apart from the project documentation that they have written, they have to submit a composite diary. An individual diary has to be maintained by every person of the team, and that diary must say, it is not a daily diary, but whenever they do a project activity, they have to write the date, start time, end time, and a brief one-line description of what activity that they did. This diary is maintained by every individual. It is consolidated by the team leader of that team at the end, where you have names of all individual participants. You do not have the start time, end time, but you have major activity component, such as discussion, review, documentation, programming, of whatever other work, thinking, reporting, consolidation, whatever work. And what you have to do is each individual person calculates the total time I have spent, for example, in review. I might start review of one submission made by a colleague, say today, I might spend 15 minutes in that. Day after tomorrow, I might review for half an hour somebody else's thing. 3 days later, I might review somebody else's thing, if I am supposed to be the reviewer of the team. Now, these entries I will be making in my diary. But at the end of the project, I must submit my team leader the total time that I have spent for review, the total time I have spent for writing emails, the total time I have spent for, let us say, writing a documentation. These timings, believe me, will not otherwise be available to us if we don't write them down the moment we finish that work. Diaries cannot be constructed at the end of the project from memory. Human memories, and believe me, I'm telling you this from experience, personal experience, unless you jot it down the same day latest. So don't sleep unless you have made the relevant entry. It will not take more than 30 seconds or 1 minute. But maintain a diary and write down what you have done in a day for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, half an hour, approximately. You will be surprised that many of you would actually spend much more time in the team assignment than what you are expected to spend, because there are unknown components of activities which will suddenly emerge where it will take your time. But it's worthwhile to document. So let me recall. Number one, you will set up standards for communication. Number two, you will set up schedule for different activities and schedule for both the communication and who will do what when, and you will define, let us say, our team will try to complete this, not in 4 weeks, but in 2 weeks itself. But then I will have to ensure that all team members agree to do more work on this day, this day, this day. The dates on which emails must be exchanged must be very clearly noted down and agreed to by everyone. The dates on which the team leader will communicate to all other members of the team must also be agreed upon. And the team leader must ensure that such consolidation happens at the end of the team leader at the appointed time. So all that you are doing is you are fixing a schedule. In short, you are planning. And you are planning in a very deliberate fashion so that you can work almost like a military operation, well-oiled military operation throughout those 2 weeks. Without bothering about details, because you know exactly what is expected at what time. The deadlines are supposed to be hard deadlines. So please remember, when we say 12 midnight, it doesn't mean 2 minutes past midnight. We always wanted to be very careful. That is why you will notice that when we say the session will start at 11:15, if it does not start, we apologetically inform everyone that the session will start 15 minutes late or 10 minutes late. We have to learn the value of these deadlines. In that context, let me recall what my workshop team told me 3 days ago and repeated it yesterday. You will remember that the deadline for submitting the feedback related to plagiarism was 22nd midnight. A number of people have requested either by phone or by email saying, please extend this deadline. Now, this deadline is not extendable because it was a hard deadline and I had announced that hard deadline. You know what will happen as a result? There are perhaps about 100 people, I do not know. From the sample, I can estimate there could be 100 people who for some reason did not fill up that survey form and therefore are positively deprived of getting a certificate of completing this FDP, although they have done all the work diligently and they will be completing even the team assignment. I apologize to such people in advance because they cannot be considered for certification. However, if they feel that they will benefit from continuing to work and learn, they are most welcome. But that is what hard deadline means. A hard deadline means every person in the team must meet that deadline of the activity, not even 1 minute late. And let us learn all of this ourselves. Let us practice all of this ourselves so that when we train our students, then we train them properly. I do not know, but I can tell you the difference between the college where I studied, the SJSITS Indore, it was one of the good colleges like all your colleges, and the IIT Bombay system. In my college, there used to be deadlines announced by the teachers saying this assignment is due this time. A few people go to him, sir, parso holi thi, to wo holi mein nache gaye, to kisi ne kaam nahi kiya, ja do din ka extension de. The teacher perhaps also has enjoyed the holi in the same manner, so he says, okay, 2 more days. That means we announce deadlines, then we announce extension to those deadlines, then we announce further extension to those deadlines, and this becomes a matter of practice to the extent that our students assume that a deadline will be extended. And because they do so, they also assume that deadlines will be extended. The difference between developing world and developed world is that the developed world does not believe in extension of deadline. A deadline is a hard deadline. We are now becoming a developed world. You are the front-end representatives of that developed world, being trained in a manner of using the most modern technology for effective education. You have to respond to that call, saying that you will set and honor hard deadlines. And if you miss the deadline, sorry, you miss it. Something is not done, that's it. So that is why the deadlines that you set for the teamwork have to be hard deadline and they have to be honored. I will tell you a trick by which you can maintain these hard deadlines and their sanctity. Suppose the hard deadline is tomorrow evening. Then the best bet is to complete that work by tonight, latest by tomorrow morning itself. Hard deadline does not mean that we have to wait till the end to complete that work. The work can be done earlier. It is only a human psychology which says, "Arey, abhi time hai, 4 ghanta time," and therefore we can be delayed. This scheduling that you will do is the draft scheduling for your project. Try to perfect as much as is possible. Today afternoon, if it is possible for you, I would like you to have 2 sessions. Of course, the first priority is to complete the assessment work of Dr. Samir Sastrabuddha's portion. But I guess many of you would have completed it and that may not take much time. I would suggest that at each remote center, there should be individual team meetings first, where individual members of the team will discuss and decide. I would suggest take about half an hour to take that decision. Half an hour to 45 minutes. Spend 10 minutes in writing down whatever you have decided. This godagiri, of course, has to be done by the team leader, who, as I said, will get more credit for the overall project anyway. But all other people can assist. Once you have decided on this, spend some time on more time on deciding on what particular activity you would like to undertake as the team assignment. And of course, the other thing that I mentioned. Towards the end, I would request all such teams to come together and have a collective meeting where individual team leaders or any member try to suggest that they have formulated such and such scheme for file nomenclature, for scheduling, for email standardization, etc., etc., and share the thoughts with everyone. Who knows? Some of the teams might have come up with something which is more useful as a process than some other teams. Try to evolve the best process that you think and discuss this jointly. This meeting will not require more than 40 minutes. 30 to 40 minutes is the time which should be coordinated by the workshop coordinator, and not every member of the community, because every remote center has anywhere between 20 to 50 people. Of course, a remote center which has 50 or more people, they might break themselves into two groups to conduct that discussion. Because the idea is not that everybody speaks there, but the idea is you know exactly what common inputs that we need to share, and those inputs have to be given by a few representatives. There could be some discussion on whether this approach is better or that approach is better. A major part of the teamwork is running such meetings efficiently. So I'll tell you two things about running meetings which the developer practices. First of all, no meeting ever takes place without a written agenda. Second, for each agenda item, there is an estimated time which is written against that agenda item. 7 minutes for this, 10 minutes for this, 15 minutes for this, 3 minutes for this. Third, there is a timekeeper who is neither the president of that meeting, namely the workshop coordinator here, nor individual team leaders. Any one person who is chosen and appointed, and that person does nothing but start shouting the moment those 7 minutes are over for a particular. So he will politely mention that for this particular agenda item, we had fixed 7 minutes. Already two people have spoken for 3 minutes each. Now we have to conclude and write down the conclusion in 1 minute sharp. And at the end of 7th minute, the timekeeper must force the chairman of the committee or the meeting to go to the next item. We are not used to functioning like that. It is very, very important that we learn it. And I suggest that you use the opportunity of this face-to-face interaction. Remember, I had mentioned this earlier also, because there was a feeling in the minds of many participants that face-to-face interaction means that is the time when we interact with the faculty at IIT Bombay. Of course, that is one part that you do. But this, the other important part, perhaps more important part, is you interact with each other. And that opportunity you will not get once you go back to your respective places, colleges or homes. Please try to inculcate this learning, how to conduct a meeting efficiently. The responsibility should be taken by the workshop coordinator. Any one person can act as a timekeeper. The person, of course, participates in the meeting and deliberations. But the primary attention of that person is on the watch. This time is gone, now nothing more will be. So at the very beginning, in this meeting, I suggest that the workshop coordinator should announce that we shall discuss these three items today. And for each item, we have these 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes or whatever. And then we'll have a concluding discussion for 7 minutes. And final conclusions will be announced in the last 1 minute. This is the way in which you can conduct a proper meeting. Of course, since you are all faculty members, you must be participating in your faculty meetings of the institute or the departmental faculty meetings. But I can suspect that neither the institute faculty meeting nor the departmental faculty meeting is conducted with explicit attention to time span for every individual item? Do you have in your faculty meeting the amount of time listed against each agenda item for which the deliberations will take place? Most faculty meetings do not have such time. Those who have such time written down, I will ask the next question. Are you 100% sure that in every faculty meeting, the time is adhered to scrupulously and not a single minute is spent more than that? It does not happen. The reason is simple. Indians are very expensive people. Expansive people, not expensive. That means for them, time is unlimited. It flows from minus infinity to plus infinity. So while time actually is unlimited, the time available to us is limited. Overall, it is on an average 100 years, out of which we spend so much time in doing the FDP, which is 10 weeks online plus another 3-4 weeks. And when we come face to face, the time is still more limited. And therefore, every second, every minute of that time must be meaningfully utilized. Please remember, conducting a meeting is actually an extremely important exercise as part of the teamwork. Here is a large team coming together for deliberating on something important and yet not being critical of the use of time for which the meeting is taking place. So please utilize this critical time. Learn something from this teamwork also called conducting a meeting efficiently. I will conclude by saying that the team assignment that you will do is an extremely important component of the entire FDP. In the earlier part, you have been learning from experts different things, practicing those through assignments and quizzes and so on. But in this part, what you do is entirely your own work. A small team of people, 2 to 4 people, will be doing that work. I will say this again. There will be additional description, by the way, of what you have to submit. You have to submit tags, for example. Did I mention tags that are to be submitted along with OER that you give? These are the tags which are words or phrases which can be used as a parameter for searching. So if I say thermodynamics, for example, then if thermodynamics is a tag on any of the OERs, when I search thermodynamics, all 22 OERs pertaining to thermodynamics should show up. Okay. So I will explain about tagging in the next week's activities, but you will have to create such tags when you submit these, and creating tags has to happen while you are creating the material itself. The historical capture of activities automatically happens on MOOC's platform. All the activities that you have been doing on IIT Bombay X, for example, are logged. So all activity logs are there. Who saw which video when is logged. Who attempted which quiz when is logged. And we'll now be doing a downloading of all those event logs, gigabytes of logs, and we'll be writing programs to automatically analyze them to learn about the statistical behavior of the participants. However, what is not logged is the individual diaries. For example, how long I spent in thinking about a topic cannot be captured online. But if you send an email, that can be captured. When an email was sent, by whom, what was the subject of that email is known. What was the attachment to that email is known. And that is how, once you start creating digital records, it will be easier for you to ensure that your diaries are properly written, because all the timings, etc., can be captured. But please note that digital capture will only be capture of an event when it occurs. That capture or that event log can never tell me the total time that an individual has spent on an activity. And that is why, while such capture is important, writing your diaries is equally important. In this week, you will get progressively, first you will get some material describing how the collaborative work is done. You will have to look at some websites to which suggest how groups can collaborate. But towards the middle of this week, or perhaps on Thursday, I will upload an additional PDF file, which will give you our thinking of what should be the diary entries that individuals should write and the diary entries that the consolidated diary should be submitted by the team leader. You may take that as an input, which is the format in which you will have to submit. But that will come only on Thursday. Meanwhile, please remember, every one of you has to record any activity that you do now after today evening, which goes towards the team effort. Even if you spend 10 minutes some time in thinking about an idea and jotting down a few things and then send an email, you must have a record when you spend that time and what activity you do. As I said, I am looking forward to having all these 2,500 people turning out to be expert collaborators with me in our future efforts to train larger number of people. Not all of them will be our teaching associates in future, but I stand by my commitment that we will be identifying 200 participants who will be honored with the recognition of the SAP Award of Excellence. I think there is a small non-trivial amount of rupees 5,000. That is the SAP award that we'll be giving. It is not for the award that I am delighted to see things happening. This is the first FDP when my workshop team and all teachers are reporting that the activity levels are immensely high. One of the reasons could be that this is the first time, because we have the IIT Bombay X platform, where online quizzes are being conducted and submissions are being done with peer assessment. I must mention a curious happening where many people in their interaction have said that this peer assessment is a bunkum thing, that there are peers who are not spending time in assessing properly. I recall observing when Professor Kannan was conducting his session, a angry lady saying that two of the peers gave her 16 out of 20 and 17 out of 20, but one person gave zero. And she cannot understand how anybody can give zero marks. This is something you write, even to our student. If something irrelevant is written, there also we give half mark or one mark. How can somebody give zero? What it means is that that particular gentleman or lady was completely careless, giving 0, 0, 0. Some others might be careless in giving 20, 20, 20. One solution is that when you do such peer assessment, you remove the outliers. Statistically, outlier means that anything which is highest, anything which is lowest is removed, and you take the average of the remaining mark. Average in general is supposed to reflect an overall assessment which is more accurate. However, this was the first time when we applied the peer assessment for this, and therefore there are many broken hearts where I genuinely believe I have done good work, but because this peer assessment, and that too because some peer doing something haphazardly, not being careful, is causing me problem. Well, I sympathize with such people. The worry that many participants have is that while they have struggled hard to give all the quizzes and assignments, if they score less than 50% marks because of this idiotic peer giving me zero here and there, then is that fair? Well, I will mention two things here. Number one, life is not fair. After all, are we fair to our students? How many times we have observed either us falling to that temptation of quickly correcting the answer books and returning them by giving arbitrary marks? How many times we have known of the cases of our own colleagues who don't do serious work of examining? Do students complain? They don't even know what has happened. They just get marks from their university. I think it is important that we collectively rise up to the occasion. More important, the second observation, if the participants are worried that they may lose out on getting a certification just because a few peers have behaved idiotically, let me assure you that such a thing will not happen. That whenever we consolidate all the assessment marks, the quantitative marks of all participants, and if the marks fall short of 50%, which was announced as the minimum qualifying thing, I will personally spend time with my colleagues in examine those cases, which you may call boundary cases. So somebody has got 45% or 40%, okay, and they fall short of some percentage. And wherever we find that in those cases, the marks are lost because of such peer assessment, we will ensure that the benefit of doubt is given to them. So that is my personal promise, because the objective is not to deprive people of a certificate for which they have worked hard. But the objective is for all of us to understand the process of such online activities and peer assessment, both individually and collectively. At least if I have suffered because some idiot has given me zero marks, it should also teach me that in future, when I am called upon to do this peer assessment, I will spend my time diligently to do that work and do it properly. So as long as I learn that, I have benefited from the FDP, and therefore I deserve to be certified. So don't worry on that count, we'll take care of. Well, that's all I wanted to say. I conclude this interaction by thanking all of you for participating very vigorously, complimenting all of you for actually sustained a very long-term activity and promising to sustain it more, not only for the 10 weeks of the online activity, but even for 4 more weeks to continue to do this teamwork properly. I look forward to some absolutely excellent contributions coming out of this teamwork, and I look forward to getting maybe at least 50 top class contributors to our future efforts in the form of what I call teaching associates for the future FDP program. I would like to compliment in advance those 200 people which will emerge as the top performers. Right now we do not know who those are. We will see how we could honor them and recognize them better, apart from just sending some money in their bank accounts. We would like to recognize them by publicizing their names on all our website, by writing individual personal letters, I will do that personally, to all heads of their institutions, and by writing a consolidated letter to the chairman of AICT, mentioning these people by the name and their affiliation. Of course, the AICT chairman will get a complete list of all the people who get certified in this FDP, because I have suggested to him that if individual colleges wish to conduct such programs, we will assist them in doing that at their local level, provided they have participants who have successfully completed this FDP and therefore can be considered as perfectly eligible and competent to conduct this FDP on their own. With that hope and with that promise, I take your leave. Thank you so much. Over and out.